Am I doing my thing now? Yes? Wow. It's an honor being here. Hi, my name is Dirk. Hi, my name is Fredrik Alexandersson, but most people actually know me more by my hacker hand as Dirk. And I'm gonna welcome all you to my talk, Weaponizing Plain Text, ANSI Escape Sequences as a Forensic Nightmare. And leading up to this talk, I was kind of told that you need to have this table of content that explains things that are going to happen, because otherwise people get bored and really sad. But I figured that we got 281 slides to go through, so screw that other thing and just head straight into it. Thank you. So I spent a good time of digging into this vulnerability class CV150 that's been dormant for the last two decades or so, and that was real fun, and that's what this talk is all about. But I used to travel the world to all these live hacking events and create educational videos on YouTube. But nowadays I fight cybercrime over at TruSec, and I also do shitloads of incident response, so I realized that I'm really passionate about getting log files, because that's kind of the whole part of creating a good timeline. So I figured that maybe I'm the only one, maybe some other people like log files too. So I went on the application formerly known as Twitter and asked, are log files important? And I got a bunch of really good answers coming back. And the short answer is kind of like, yes. Log files are important because logs are a vital component for maintaining application reliability, performance, and security. But it also seems like the common idea is that logs don't lie, people do. And even though your log files might just not lie to you, do you still trust them? And what happens if you don't? Because imagine this for a second. You are now the incident response lead of a global logistics corporation. It's 4 o'clock in the morning and you're sound asleep in your bed, dreaming about boats or maybe containers into Docker and stuff. When you get this rude awakening call from your manager that's pissed because you got breached. And since you are the incident response lead, it's your responsibility to call up all those tired people that work in the incident response team and get those starting with collecting all the logs that you need to be able to create the timeline. You're a manager, so you don't do grunt work, so you log into your big data app 4000, and since you're a professional, you log shipped stuff already, so you export the data, save it into a local file called everything.log. You're happy. But just to verify that you got any data in there, you decided that maybe I should just cat the file and see what's in there. In the beginning, everything looks just great. It contains the things that you wanted, but then suddenly, out of nowhere, boom! You're getting an ad for a restoring service, and they're nice enough to provide you with a calculator so you can do the math for how much it's going to cost you. And that's kind of the situation where you're starting to realize that, shit. And the reason for all this is that it has to do with ANSI escape sequences. And what got me all into this CVE here. And I was just gonna read this straight out from my monitor because I didn't remember it all. Effective versions of this package are vulnerable to arbitrary code injection. Or there we are interested, right? This is a possible shell escape sequence injection vulnerability in racks, lint, and common logger components. Carefully crafted requests can cause shell escape sequences to be written to the terminal via racks, lint, middleware, and common logger middleware. Okay. These escape sequences can be leveraged to possibly execute commands in the victim's terminal. Audio guy, are you with me?
Excuse me, tiny Dirk. What do you mean, possibly? Either you can or you cannot run arbitrary commands, right?
Well, yeah, thank you for that, giant Dirk, for pitching in and helping out here in the presentation. Well, you're actually right. It depends, but it apparently depends on the terminal that you're using. And there's a shitload of different terminals out there today, and some of them come built into the software that you're using, like VS Code and Docker. Then you have like third-party stuff like iTerm, Kitty, and other ones, and stuff that people built on their own. Then you have the ones that get shipped within your with your operational system, like Windows Terminal, Terminal.app, GNOME, VT, and other stuff. And then you've got old stuff like Xterm. So, we also got this in when we're in the cloud. Maybe you don't know this, but if you're going to try to use a DigitalOcean to connect to your droplet, or you're going to do some recovery console stuff, that is actually like a Xterm thingy connecting to that over TTY, you will be able to interact with it. It's a terminal. And I wasn't really interested in the possibly part. I wanted to execute commands in the victim terminals, but I had no idea where to begin. It sounded cool. So I did everything that every self-respecting researcher do. I Googled what ANSI escape codes were. I had no idea. And I quickly realized that people actually like to customize their terminals in the weirdest kind of ways, especially if you're using Arc. And this is the thing that just got me interested. Like, oh, cool, you can change colors and stuff. But I also realized that in 1978, the Gillstrand boys dropped their banger album, We're Gonna Have Some Fun Tonight. But even though it was released the same year, the VT100 terminal, and connecting that using serial cables to a big VAX system is probably not what those guys thought would be fun to do on a Saturday night. Even though I personally would think that would kind of cool. But I also realized that ANSI escape sequences are the shit that put stuff on your terminal that you look at. And it can do stuff like you can move the cursor around, you can remap the keys using these, and you can actually print stuff. Ding! Interesting. But you can also build whole UIs, like all this UI here is built in ANSI escape codes. Positioning of stuff, colors and output and all that, refreshing, clearing screens. All that is part of something called the control sequences standard. This is the standard for Xterm, and it's vast and it's super hard to understand. I know you're all super smart. I wasn't, so I'm gonna go through the basics with you. And the first I started looking through the documentation, it said, CSI, PM, character attribute, something, something. No idea what that meant, but it's this. So all it actually is printing out something that turns into green. Cool. And the reason why this works is due to this funny thing here called the escape character. That's important to remember. And it's also a non-visible escape character. And it comes in many shapes and forms, because the reason why they didn't print out exactly the command is because it depends if you're using octal, hex, Unicode, decimal, or ASCII. All of these are the same sequence, it's a different kind of ways to portrait it. And I also realized that Bash likes octal, Python likes hex, Java and JavaScript likes Unicode, and PowerShell likes decimal for some reason. And this escape character here is the one that starts the whole sequence. It needs to start with that. Then we have this control sequence introducer, which is, tells the terminal to do shit. Next one is the parameter, the number. So we'll go 32, which is green here. M is to change whatever continuous output, turning that into green, which is the string we have here. And then we're just going to close it off with another escape character, another control sequence introducer, and this is the important part. Here we do 0M, and that means we're resetting the terminal back, and then, because if you don't do that, apparently this is going to happen. The rest of your shit is going to be all green. Hulk smash. But we need to terminate this using a ST or string terminator or bell character. It's one that, and if you, well, if you're like me and you accidentally kind of like gripped something, you know, minus A, and then your terminal starts like ding, 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 that is it being interpreted as the bell character. So we got escape sequences being shoved in there. So I thought, okay, cool, that's fun. I can put colors on my screen. Fancy. What happens if I put that in something called a bad log and see what happens and then interact with it? Well, if I'm using Vim, it's going to show the exact what the escape character is. It's this one here. And that's cool because it's not rendering, it just shows it. Same for Nano, if you're using that, you're cool. And if you're using a browser, instead it's going to show it as Unicode. So that's also interesting to know. Different, it's get interpreted differently depending on the system you're using. But if you cat it, color's going to get displayed. Grip, tail, orchid, the same thing. And if you, even if you curl it, boom, fun stuff's going to happen. Because all these systems interpret the sequence and renders it. And at this stage, when I ran this through curl, I'm like, shit, what just happened? What just happened? And I started thinking, where can I stuff this? Where that would interact with other people's stuff. So I figured, why not do it in a text record? Because DNS is always the source for all evil. So I put it in there. And I ran it and ran NS lookup on it on OS X. Nothing happened. And you can see here, the extra slash in front of it means that it's escaped. It's beautifully escaped. This is a real good thing. If you're doing that on Windows, though, it's a different kind of story. So it depends on what kind of OS you're using. And big ups to David for showing that. That was real cool. So I was starting to ask myself, like, OK, cool, that's fun. But is this even a security issue? Seriously? So this kind of feels like this self-XXS thing where you're like, OK, I can put colors on my terminal fun times. So I need to figure out who would this be an issue for? Where would this be an issue? How would this be an issue? And what would be the consequences of this? Well, the where wasn't that hard to figure out. Apparently, since we had the common logger thing, log injection would be the way to go. And who would it affect? I reckon DevOps, sysadmin, IR forensic people, or anyone that interacts with a log files using a terminal. And we can take a quick break here. How many of you have ever catted, grepped, or JQ'd a file that you parsed from some other software? I love you. So, to do this as the scientists we are, researchers, we're professionals. Log injection vulnerabilities occur according to OWASP when data enters application from an untrusted source. Yes. The data is written to an application or a system log file. Cool. I needed to adapt that because this is kind of written to do XSS stuff, so I figured that, okay, to successfully have this as a measurement, I needed to be able to inject new log files or events by forging a log. I needed to be able to inject the escape sequence, and I needed to, in some way or form, make that run in someone's terminal emulator. And I also needed that injection to execute some kind of stuff. And I figured, which would be the best test bench for this, huh? And Docker, obviously, because it loves to send whatever logs to standard out. It has this real live log that's running through that actually a terminal rendering stuff. And it comes with a really nifty getting started kind of app. Good stuff. I'll go for that. So, and also a way for you, if you want to attach your work with Docker, you would use Docker attach inside a terminal, connect to it, or Docker logs to do like a tail and see whatever happens inside your container. I'm like, seems tasty enough for me. But I also realized that I couldn't just take this printf thing and stuff it in a browser because, hey, shit, you can't do that. No. So I needed to URL encode it. And for good measure, we added a new line in there because everyone knows that if you're triaging some kind of bugs, new lines are very important to show that it's actually able to inject some kind of false log entries. So I figured, why not see? Well, let's see what happens if I curl this and you send that straight in. And I was really excited when I realized that, oh, nothing came back. Then I started looking the log, and over here it's like, oh ho, nothing comes in the return in the response, but new line has been entered. The color has been rendered inside the log that's being displayed in real time, which means like on the first try, more or less, we checked all the boxes to prove a successful log injection. Because we're injecting new lines, we are enabled to run escape sequences that will be viewed in a terminal emulator, in this case, Docker. And I'm able to inject commands that the terminal emulator could execute. In this case, we're changing the color. Because remember, even though that was the only line that I put in, we can create this. Because it's all about the limitations and creativity of whoever decides to design this. And even though I'm like, fuck yeah, confirmed. The Yildstrand boys, weren't that impressed. They wanted me to provide more impact. So I'm like, okay, I can do that. I started, once again, Googling stuff, and then I stumbled upon this great research from 2003 by H.D. Moore. And he found a really, really interesting, cool way to just misuse the terminal and use it against them in a way. So what happens here is that they were able to use something called OSC2 sequence, where you will actually put this on the command line, and that would change the title of the terminal you're in. And if you're currently like using a terminal, you're changing directories and stuff, and it just updates there inside the title that I've seen that, or you're connecting to a shell, it's changing it. That is actually this sequence doing that. But that wasn't enough. They digged into the deeper parts of the whole documentation and realized that in this CSI code here, 21T, you were actually able to report back whatever was put inside the title and push that to the command line. That could only mean trouble. Because even if this stuff would be put on the command line, and in this case, you needed to have a social interaction with the user. The user needs to be fooled into pressing enter. It's still a cool way to just push something in the title, read it back, and then boom, shit happens. But that's been fixed for ages. 2003, if you want to feel old, is like 2 decades ago. So I started searching some more, and I found this really nice write-up from Evil Alive Jekyll and ASCII that did some cool research on all these different web servers back in 2010, where they're using the same kind of sequence here. But we know that's been fixed, so can't do much with that. But then in 2022, Evitar Gersi released some, sorry for trashing the name, don't know how to pronounce it. A cool way they created a DOS sequence when they were able to read a bunch of stuff into the title and just creating crashes. And I'm just tasting buffer overflows here for the future to come. But that's been fixed too. So here I am feeling like an epic fail. Can't do the arbitrary command injection. That seems so cool that the person talked about in the CBE. So I did the thing. I think the end is the only thing you do. You reach out to the original poster and ask them, can I ask the RC POC? And they answer back, I didn't write any. I used this paper as a reference. And that sucks because we know that's fixed. So here I am, super excited, but all I got old stuff. And speaking about old stuff, this is what I looked like in the 80s. No, I'm kidding. I'm probably more like this badass here. And if you look at the angle of the arm here, that's very important because it's exactly the same angle as this gentleman here in this band poster. And that's pretty fucking darn cool because he was one of the first people to sell Diab and Unix computers in Sweden. And not only that, he's my dad. So I'm very grateful to him to put stuff and gave me access to computers at an early age. Thank you. But I'm starting to look at this picture, and I'm starting to realize that maybe I'm looking more like Lasse that was on the same tour as my dad when he met my mom. Anyway, the standard is vast and it's deep and it takes a lot of things to go through. But that wasn't enough for the fine developers and users of terminals of today. No, they wanted more. Because all these different terminals have different kind of functionality. And you know, with more features, we need more stuff. So they invited something called proprietary escape codes, which is a local edition of the standard. And it works in certain terminals, not all of them. Some of them are being shared internally and some work over the whole bar. And what that does is gives you the opportunity to, you know, make a fun twirly thing maybe in your title, get notifications and all this other cool stuff that's in there. Maybe even change your background, fancy stuff. But some thought that it was a great idea to always run some processes with arguments. Why not using escape sequences? I mean, that's a really bad idea. But luckily enough, it's as rare to find stuff that runs a really bad idea too nowadays because it's old and it's been fixed. So I needed to find something that was like adapted by everyone, everybody loved it and trusted, and they thought it was nice that we could weaponize. Why not? Because we are tricksy hobbitses. And I found OSC8. I'm like, cool. If you ever run PowerShell and you mess that up, you'll get this prompt coming back, says, you suck, click this link and somebody's gonna tell you how to do it. I'm like, cool, that seems doable. And the reason why that works is because you have this ANSI escape sequence that gives you the HTTP thing, and then it has the title or whatever you wanna print out, and then you close it off and it turns into this link inside your terminal. And that's great. Initially, that was only allowed to use URI like HTTP and HTTPS. But recently, the fine people over at Windows Terminal decided that we should allow file too. That's even a great idea. Because what could even happen if you typed in CMD there and clicked it? I wonder. Fun things popping inside user space. And even though this is kind of filtered in a way where you can start CMD but you can't use any parameters, I'm willing to guess that some smart person in here are gonna figure out how to bypass that, put a link in and pop shells. It's definitely doable. And the fun thing with OSC8 is if you don't terminate it correctly, you remember the kind of the what we did with the green when it all went Hulk everywhere? If we don't terminate it correctly, the rest of the output starting from that injection is going to be one big link. Everything is going to be a link, and if you click that, some terminals will be very nice for you and just block that out with a warning. And I figured that, okay, that's cool. I wonder if I can inject this somewhere, because obviously me putting links on my own shit would be boring. So what happens if I put that inside Docker? Well, everything's gonna turn into one big link there too. And that one has a protection in. But it's not everywhere this turns into a protection, because injections can be put in different places, and then suddenly you can click links and you can just imagine how fun this could be. But that wasn't enough for people, because, you know, text is cool, but inline image support, that's definitely something we need in text space. So the Windows Terminal people, they decided to adapt the inline support for it in the recent build, where you're able to do, you have CXL and inline support inside the terminal. And that's great. I see no problem with that. I think that's great. I just wonder what's going to be inside this log file. So can I get a raise of hands of how many of you wants to see what's in that log file? I love you. And it's not what you thought it would be. Shame on you! Then we have OSC52, which is great. If you ever used tmux or anything, and back in the days you weren't able to copy paste between shells, sucked. Now you can. The reason is OSC52. And what it does is that it takes this sequence, if you have something base 64 coded, it's gonna put that inside user space clipboard. Super sweet, great. I wonder what happens if we do open a something calculator app and a new line on the end, because we need that new line. If you put that into CSH and paste it, this is what's gonna happen. It requires the users to do something. And you press that, boom, okay, it pops calc. But if you do the same thing in Bash, Bash honors the new line. So if you just paste it straight in there, it fires it directly. There are room for improvement here, though. So I figured, I wonder, how can I test this in different spaces? I did this kind of base 64 string with these commands in it and said, I'm curious what's going to happen. And I started to paste that in different places. Docker, that fired directly, that was nice. VS Code, it did it differently depending on what kind of shell you're using. And even in some cases gave you this warning, which is super good. Of course, it was your own people. Terminal.app honors it, runs it directly. And even, you know, you will get inside Windows Terminal, you will get even this preview of showing things that are bad. And the reason for that is that if you wanted to run this command 10 lines and do whom I, Windows Terminal is going to be nice of you to show the first lines and tell you, yeah, you got your shit going on here. So why not just add 7 lines of nothing and then see what happens? Well, it's nothing in there. So, and everybody knows that nobody's gonna scroll down. And what happens if you add 400 lines in there? Nobody ever gonna scroll down. Or you can even, in this, add some kind of those ULA things, then people just press okay. So it, with that in there, it's going to, okay, it's just running it. I think that's pretty cool. It's a decent thing. So I think, okay, so I have this certain thing for Windows Terminal, I got one for Bash. Let's create a polyglot and see what happens. So I figured that why not have a little bit of an SVG in there? You stop that one off with a good old hash mark at the end. Do a curl command. Obviously, we want this to run locally and not fuck around on the interwebs. So, and then we do a PowerShell kind of mix where we're using CMD that calls PowerShell and stuff because we want it to work in whatever kind of environment you end up in. And we want to exfiltrate stuff to know what's happening. So here's the hash that's important, and then eventually this last one here. Encode that into one big base64 thing and just send that to bad log, cat bad log, and then start pasting it in places. Well, it obviously worked there. This removed all the info in the beginning. It's going to pop here too. And if you go to the browser and you paste that in, you have some JavaScript running, which is great. Then you can just refresh it here, and you'll see that, okay, it's running who am I and a different other kind of stuff in there that's just exfiltrating stuff for you inside the request. And this is just being dormant in some poor bastard's clipboard by just interacting with the file. Because you can sit there and work, you catch something, and then you decide to paste, and boom, it's on you. It's not limited there. Obviously, you can exfiltrate stuff like sending things out and doing reverse shells and all that. I didn't go through that in this demo. You are smart people. You know what to do. But if we're doing this, we might just want to hide our tracks or just mess things up because we can. And there's different ways to do this. You can use everything from just moving the cursor to a certain position. You can clear the screen. You can erase stuff or clear the scroll back buffer. And to showcase this, I'm just putting like 15 lines here on the screen for you. And then we're just going to run the command and blip, it's empty. And that's perfect to have a proof of concept of myself. But what happens if we run that inside, let's say, this Docker instance and we send in the reset screen and just go back? Well, this is what's going to happen. It empties the log file for you. And every time you load it, all the way up to that's getting rendered, it's going to clean it anyway for you. So you need to sanitize and clean that out. Fun. And that is somewhat annoying for anyone that's using that. That's really annoying. But it's not annoying enough. We need to DOS and brick stuff to really be annoying. And why not use the standard? Like, we have this print screen functionality. We give us the opportunity, if we're typing that one in, it will bing, send in the printer prompt for you. Imagine getting that every minute or so. It can be annoying. But you can also do this cool thing. If you, instead of doing the 0i, you can do 5i. Because back in the days, we used to have matrix printer next to our computers that are like, having a paper copy of said log. We don't have those anymore, so we can just send anything out to this buffer that doesn't exist, which means, as you can see here, if you send it in, all the commands are going to send into Vian, and it's still going to render, but you can't see shit, so that's really annoying. And it's, the only way to get rid of that is to close the browser. But it's not annoying enough. No, we need to be really annoying. And one way to do that is to use the mouse tracking functionality. It was great if you ever like install some kind of, I don't know, Slackware or something or whatever, Debian, and you're in that CLI mode and you suddenly realize my mouse works and I can click on stuff. That's cool. That is the reason because somebody's tracking what kind of where your mouse are in that state. And if you run that on on the terminal and move your mouse around, it's going to report all that stuff all the time. And if you click, it's going to execute whatever kind of happened there. And what's really interesting when this doing this is that imagine you're sneaking some other shit in there and somebody clicks stuff and then boom, it's going to pop it. Fun. And if you combine those with, you see where I'm going with a bunch of chains here, you can just combine those things together and just create a lot of interesting stuff. But then I stumbled upon this one here. Looks so sweet, and it's perfect. Repeat the preceding graphic character X amount of times. And yeah, that's perfect. You want to measure like how big a terminal screen are. And so in this case, let's see that we wanted to repeat this 10 times. It's going to do it 10 times for us in the output of the terminal. But one simply wonders. A billion times is a lot of fucking peace. And since this is not a single character, this is Unicode. You get five characters for the price of one. And my recommendation to you is to do not run this in prod. Things will break. Like, I can't open this Docker container again without it crashing, and when it crashes, it kills Docker desktops. I need to start it all over again. That can be somewhat annoying. Thank you. So it breaks most terminals, and some terminals, even like the one I have on my phone here, you know, it crashes that one. So it's just I'm starting to think, like, okay, that's cool. I wonder what happens. What can I do to weaponize this? Maybe if I put it in my service signature on a host and then request a let's encrypt certificate. I wonder if the bots will come running. I'm betting you, there's a bunch of fucking automation scripts that's gonna scrape and look for kind of version I'm running that's gonna get dust out whenever somebody decides to look at that entry. Real fun. Okay, you got a question, scary looking kid? No RC? No. I know, I wasn't able to do any kind of arbitrary command injection. Sucks. I got malicious stuff, but not really bad stuff. So these were dark times in the middle of my research. But then light came in the shape of David Leadbeater. And his amazing fucking talk, sorry, pardon my French, at Blue Hat 2023 called Houdini in the Terminal, where he doesn't provide just one. No, he brings on six remote code executions in terminals that are live today. I'm like, tasty. David knows stuff. And he's doing that, but I'll use kind of the same thing that HD Moore back in the days with this CRLF injection, but he's using something called device control reconstructing. I'm not going to try to pronounce that. If you want to check out his Git repo, he's really, really good. He's got a lot of cool stuff there. And he's speaking tomorrow here, so please go visit that talk. I'm going to be there, and the Yield Stein boys is definitely going to be there because he's going to release some banger stuff, and you don't want to miss that. So this is all David's work, but I'm going to show it now because, hey, why not? So I figured that he had this thing provided. I needed to put that in a way that I could infiltrate others. So I basically for this string here, more or less this is kind of what it does. It sends in a bunch of control sequences and stuff. I'm not going to bore you with that, but more or less what it does, it asks you what kind of color you have on the screen, but we're feeding that with other stuff instead, and then adding new lines and voila, bob, fun stuff. So if you're using version 3.17 of iTerm, which is not the newest one, it's been patched now, and you're interacting with the logs using this Docker. And what's going to happen if I paste that inside your terminal and you're running that libtail? I'm going to pop calc for you. Why not? Super simple way to just make sure that things break. So update your iTerms, people, if you're playing around with that. And the reason why this is working, and I love this, is simply because what David figured out is that he could sneak in X03 here, which is control C kind of thing, or control X. So you're escaping out of whatever thing that's running, and imagine what happens if you're trying to like escape out of a Docker attach sequence. It's gonna shut down the Docker. And after that, we're adding whatever command that we want to run, and then simply we're going back again and tells the system, could you please report back for us whatever kind of color that we're running, but we already tainted that with other stuff, so it's just gonna boom, which is great. And for me, David was this kind of Mike Metzger moment for me when he did that stuff, because what Mike did for the motocross circuit was that just before he did the first backflip in competition, it was like rumors and shit, and nobody thought it would even remotely possible. But as soon as he did that, today, if you're not doing like a double flip, can, woohoo, fuck a thing, you suck. So that was kind of the opener. So I started to look at this OSC 5113, which I thought was like, Kitty has this proprietary escape code. I wonder what that does. And what I figure out real fast is that test here reflects back. in the flow. So I'm starting to think, what happens if we add a new line and open a bit of calculator there and send that away? Well, let's see what happens. What's going to happen first is it's going to give you a request. Are you really sure you want to do this? You say, no, but you got a calculator. Because it's adding new lines and it's honoring them. Time is running out. Thanks, babe. The other one here, and I know you said, yeah, but you press no. What happens if you press yes? Well, I can figure it out. It's the same. No escaping here. Yieldstein boys, fuck yeah. I thought that was sweet. So now I'm getting hyped and I'm all happy about it. And this shows the whole proof of concept. Is it actually possible to execute commands in the victim terminal? And the short answer to this is yes. But whose fault is it? This conversation has been going on for like the last 10, 20 years, because every 10 years or so, somebody's going to poke around at this stuff, and they say, and the terminal developers are going to say, it is the developer's fault, they need to do their shit. The app people say, no, it's the terminal people, they need to stop using escape sequences at all. It's a terrible idea. But we all use them all the time. And then this is the third part, it's these super angry old developers are sitting in the back, I see you, that thinks that everyone with a brain knows that you can't just cat a file or click on an email link. But that's simply not true. Because we are cybersecurity professionals, some more malicious ones, and we need to protect our users, especially our shell users, because they also are privileged users using these systems on a daily basis. And they should be able to grepcat or JQ whatever shit that's running inside the terminal without any issues, especially if they're downloading files from a third party that took care of them. And the only way to do that is that we need to sanitize our input and escape our output. And if we don't do that, it's going to be consequences. And I figured it would be kind of cool, what happens if I took this web page and stuck a bunch of different kind of escape sequences in there and see what happens? So I created this evil.terminalinjection.com site. So if you curl that inside your terminal, any of them, you can see what happens. It's not going to do anything bad stuff for you. It's going to pop a calc if you're vulnerable, but I'm not exfiltrating your data. You can just right-click the source and see what's in there. It's cool. And if you run that, on some systems it's going to be all right, on other systems when you do it, it's not going to be such all right. So it's kind of trusted things, but it will break stuff. So if we're doing black box testing on this, the whole game, if you're hunting for bugs, is going to 400, 500 errors, because 200 errors usually ends up in access logs, and those are well sanitized and nice and all. So the easiest way to do this, to break stuff, is to take whatever kind of thing you have here. This is an API JSON request. You have a key and some value stuff, and just append shit on the end and see what happens. Sometimes it will break and you will get some information coming back. And if it does contain something like unescaped stuff, because this one here is a big chance that it actually ended up in the error log. This one here, though, is properly escaped. So it's a good job on the devs. Fuck yeah. But sometimes, you know, you put that stuff in and it's going to sanitize with a backslash, so why not put some invisible characters and hex in there? The result is going to be really interesting, because then it might just render anyway, because you're bypassing the whole backslash scenario. Okay, this is very prone to false positives. So sometimes the developers are really good at just filtering the kind of output comes out, they're stripping the error message, and they're even not displaying any data. We saw that in the beginning. It was an error, but nothing happened, but it smashed in the log. Boom. So even though, you know, you need to take that into the consideration. And even though if you see like 400 errors, they're rarely logged, so 500 errors is what you're going to be looking for. But this seems to be everywhere. Everywhere I looked, it just pops and scrambles. And before you create this nuclear template and go all brr all over the internet, hoping that it's going to end up in somebody's log somewhere, to verify this, you will need to have access to the access logs and just dig into that, because otherwise it'd be a false positive. Because if I wrote the logging system and I didn't log any output, you can say that it renders, but it's not. So, time's running out. Let's recap real fast on this. People forget. The old is the new new. There's way more things that's going to come in this area. I hope you are intrigued now to start poking in this. And let's create a community around this and see whatever fun stuff we can do. And it's like everywhere. Like I told you, I created this nuclei template. And when I ran it, it rendered in there. That can be problematic. So if something's like meh today, it can easily turn into, oh, crap. By tomorrow, if somebody just decides to put a bunch of creativity in it. That means your log files, do you still trust them? I'm at Stuck for all social media. Thank you for attending my talk.